let's welcome on stage our session chair, Vanita Keswani, CEO, Madison Media Sigma. Please give her a big hand. A lady walking on stage, being a session chair, I'm feeling proud for our gender. Or just be with me for a while. Let them set up the chairs. It's wonderful to have women who run the world. Girls. Well, this is going to be very interesting, I feel. So let's welcome our panel members. Give them a big round of applause. Amit Sethia, Chief Marketing Officer, Cisco Group. Anupam Bukhe, who we met, Chief Marketing Officer, 2M Brands. Piyush Bachlaus, GM Marketing, Kansai, Nerolac Paints Limited. Vikram Tanna, VP, Head Advertising Sales and Business Head, Regional Clusters, Discovery Communications, India.
Lovely, very, very good afternoon and early evening, actually. And welcome all of you to our session on role of live events and really how do we crack the code on live event sponsorships. So before we start, and I think I'd like to introduce the esteemed panel. That's Vikram from Discovery. That's Anupam from 2YUM. You've already got him on stage recently. Amit from Cisco. And Piyush from Nerolac. And ever since I've spoken to him a while ago, by the way, I've been humming Nerolac tune. So so that's what has happened. The first part of the discussion, to even before we start what is live TV content and discuss about cracking the code and give you some learnings out there in the audience, the whole objective is to get some learnings out of the session in terms of how can we crack the code better, what are the kind of live event learnings we have. Before that, I'd just like to focus and ask ourselves, why are we discussing live event sponsorship and on television? And in one sentence, as agency, I would say that it is simply because live events command not only disproportionate eyeballs, but obviously a huge premium usually on investments, which is why we are discussing how do we crack the code, right? So having said that, I'd invite Piyush first to really talk about what his view is on what is live events on TV. So before we actually start about cracking the code, we'll just spend like 2 minutes where we'll hear what is the gamut of live television sponsorships.
Afternoon, everyone. When we were discussing, one thing which cropped up is that the classification itself is so interesting. A lot of us stop at sports. Some of us take the next step, go to news, and then we start discussing, well, there was an award concert, deferred live, does it work? And then, of course, during the conversation, I'm sure Vikram would be able to tell us more about how the deferred live or versus the entertainment piece. But surprisingly, some unconfirmed projections put the size of this opportunity that marketeers and agencies and everybody has been talking about 10,000 crores projected by 2021. So it's in no way a small piece. And from that perspective, there is money on the table. We all, through many of our own associations across properties, brands that we work on, live eyeballs is something which obviously catches all our imaginations. There is immediacy, there is cultural context that we try and build through these associations and sponsorships. And to a certain extent, there is a sense of borrowed equity which comes through for brands. Brands are working towards you know, creating specialized content, and you know, I was very interested to you know, hear in the previous session about how the content and the digitization versus television, how it is actually leading to so many more vistas and ideas coming through. But the net point being that there is specialized content which is coming through when it comes to live sponsorships. Some of our most well, you know, most successful associations or programs have actually been through live partnerships, whereby our sales force, our frontline, is actually leveraging these very effectively to grow sales end of the day. So it's the entire gamut of things that are
excellent. Thanks a lot. So what I hear him say is that broadly three top classifications that come to our mind. Of course, all of us think of sports as the first live event, biggest possibly. Second is news, which is spoken live, and what with elections coming, we'll focus a little bit towards the end of our panel. And of course, award shows that he spoke about that technically may be sometimes deferred live. But interestingly, we have Vikram on our panel, and it was so amazing and interesting to hear about some of the really different kind of events that do, live events that they do on Discovery. So let us hear the you know, the different kind of things that you all do, and how does ROI work there, and you know, how difficult is it? Let's hear your view on the kind of events first to understand what you do.
So, you know, largely Discovery programming is focused around how we inspire, educate, entertain and inform viewers. Now, when it comes to factual entertainment, I think it's one space where live really comes alive. But we really believe in storytelling, which gives you high impact in an hour. So most of our content, actually, contrary to live, is really packaged in and around where we shoot for 2 to 3 years and offer a consumer something which is for an hour. But having said that, we do some very interesting stuff in live, very few, but very interesting. Let me actually give you an example of how we believe in inspiring human lives. We had this event which was covered live on Discovery, which aired across 200 countries. We had partnered with Nick Walliden, who's actually a sky wire artist, right? He's a high wire, this thing. He diligently, on a daily basis, practices back home in Florida. When there is a storm, there is gutsy weather, and he's doing a tight rope walk, balancing himself Amazing. Without any safety yeah. devices. Now, this particular individual is so talented that he believes in pushing human limitations and giving endurance the next level. And we believe in actually partnering with these individuals and bringing them to the world. He wanted to set a new record at the Grand Canyon across a gorge. What he did interestingly is he said, let's set it up live. Of course, there is a lot which happens pre-event here, right?
Of course,
it's a lot
yeah.
of limitations.
To set it up live, yeah.
And he walked for 23 minutes. Set up a world record. No other human being had done it before. It was 1,500 feet high. And this is what was covered on Discovery live across 200 countries and broke all records when it comes to ratings. So yeah, we do a few ones, but then we stick to our core over there.
Yeah, because that's the first thing I thought when I saw his name on the panel, and I said, live events and Vikram, let me see what he has to say. And it was so interesting to hear what some of the live events that Discovery does. So anyway, having seen the gamut of what we are going to cover today on live events, let's straight on move on to the first big conversation point that anybody would want to have as a learning, is that is a GRP a GRP at all? Because television is all about buying GRPs and visibility. So live events, most advertisers who believe in live events, sponsorships, actually do not believe that a GRP is a GRP. So let's hear you know, Amit from Cisco to tell us, because they have been using a lot of sponsorships, right from, I think they were the first to do laptop branding on news. And they've done a lot of sports sponsorships, team sponsorships, etc. So do you have a way to measure ROI? And obviously it's working for Cisco. That's why you're continuing taking up, you know, live event sponsorships. Please share some light on what is the ROI you see.
See, I think when you talk about ROI, I think there are two ways to look at it. You know, the first and foremost is, you know, what kind of consumer metrics I'm trying to sort of, you know, influence. Is it awareness or is it consideration? While that's on one side, the other side is my business objective, right? So, you know, what kind of internal objectives I have, what kind of market I'm looking at, you know, what kind of competition I have in that market, I think. So whenever we have done sponsorship, I think we have always been able to rake in incremental performances by minimum, say, 20 to 25%. I think that is what keeps us going, right, from, you know, your test series to your pro kabaddi leagues, And I think there is no ending to that.
Excellent, yeah. So obviously it's measurable, right? Anyone here else who measures it and has some experience on measurement of live events versus regular?
So we've been partnering IPL for some time. And one of the metrics that we had kept for ourselves was about awareness and association on a specific set of parameters when it comes to the brand measures. And we were, apart from, of course, the GRPs, etc., a couple of things which are useful is recall measures that we do amongst people who have been exposed to the branding. Sure. And what is it that they are associating it with? So that's kind of giving us some direction on the brand parameters.
So you see a clear difference in live events versus regular on television,
yes,
clearly.
Yes.
Great. What about your experience, Anupam? Yeah.
Sorry. I'll talk about a brand which is fairly new. 2M was just launched in April of 2017. We first started advertising in December of 2017. And IPL happened in April of 2018. So, you know, a brand always has this challenge because whenever you take a property like that, it is very expensive. But does it give you the returns that are required or that justifies that investment? So I think what was important for us is to ensure to get onto the IPL bandwagon and seek participation was, do we have really assets which can engage consumers in a relevant way, in the medium when the cricket match is on? And the asset for us was, of course, 2M is a healthier snack, baked not fried, 40% less fat. But we also had our brand endorser, which is Virat Kohli. So if you have the biggest property on cricket, then I think it makes sense because it's not about, are you the biggest investor on IPL? So if you look at Vivo IPL, they would invest like upwards of what, 300 crores? The associate
sponsor. That's another strategy, now you're being.
The associate sponsor like Coca-Cola would invest 125 crores, but 2M invested 11 crores.
Lovely.
And we chose a property which was relevant in a way that whenever you're watching a match, you binge along.
Yeah,
you eat
yeah.
almost mindlessly without really being aware of what you're eating. And typically it happens to be a snack,
yeah.
A back snack. And when you actually end up watching the match, which is 3 hours or 7 hours or 8 hours, if it's a one day, and then by the end of it, you realize that you've eaten so much and you feel guilty. So 2M as a brand actually takes the guilt out of snacking because it's a healthier alternative. And we actually ask consumers to eat more. So we said, okay, if there are 13 wickets falling in a match, and you know, ek khatam, dusra shuru. So actually you can binge along through the match, and I think that was the proposition we created.
Lovely.
That was the communication
yeah.
we created. And we just took a follow wicket property. Every time a wicket fell, we said, ek khatam, dusra shuru. Eat lot, fikar not. That was the 2M proposition back then. We changed it to fried not, fikar not, making it more competitive. And that's where, you know, whenever wicket fell, that band popped up, and it popped up 720 times during the IPL because 13 wickets, 14 wickets fell in a match. So what it did was, we had a certain awareness that we had built before, but this just accelerated the awareness. Because, you know,
typically, you want to give us a sense of, exactly that's the learning we're looking at. So give us a sense, and without disclosing actual numbers, of what the awareness buildup was with your launch campaign initially, and what did it really take it up to? I mean, in terms of percentage
yeah.
or some numbers, so that we learn from the audience perspective.
So we were measuring on the top 8 metros initially,
okay.
because it was a new brand, premium, 50% premium to the market. So it was the right TG
mm-hmm.
and the right geography that we were targeting. We had reached an awareness about 20-25%
okay.
after 4 months of airing.
Okay.
From December till mid-April.
Mm-hmm.
Post the IPL 6 weeks, our awareness in mainstream metros was 65%.
Wow.
65%.
That's a huge learning, right? That's what a brand can gain.
So I think that's, you know, and why did that happen? Typically when you plan media, you plan for a frequency of 4.
Absolutely.
You'll have a reach objective of 50%, 60%, 70%. But here you are having an opportunity to have a frequency of 13 in a match of 3 hours. So you can just imagine you have accelerated the whole reinforcement 3 times
Clear.
Over in one match, which would have taken us 3 months. I think that has, because you know, post the IPL, we also continued advertising. But while the awareness has built, it hasn't built with that speed
yeah.
that we found the IPL, and that's why it was.
We've also seen that across a lot of our brands, and that's what I wanted to get from you a little bit also on Cisco. Have you seen any numbers? Can you highlight some ROI numbers on one brand versus the other, or one category versus the other? Any learnings that you can give us?
As far as Cisco is concerned, I think when you look at ROI, the important thing to look is also to figure out as to what kind of monies you are putting in, I think. And so we spoke a lot about IPL. I mean, like, undoubtedly, the league which is doing the bestest,
yeah,
I think,
it
in India.
It is the biggest now.
But
yeah.
I think if you look at the next big player, I think it's the Pro Kabaddi League.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's also about as to, how smartly you put in your bucks and say, okay, fine, am I able to get the same airtime benefit or the same kind of visibility,
Give us learnings. I want learnings on ROI. People want to know, right? You guys want to learn, know, right? How much learning?
So for me,
I
think, within the company, we launched this new brand, which is about, personal care appliances, with the help of, Pro Kabaddi League. And, we were very happy to see that, while Pro Kabaddi League was able to generate a lot of awareness for us, a lot of engagement also was generated, because there were my audiences, which are, who were ready to sort of go ahead and talk to the brand that, okay, fine, you are now moving beyond LED, because I'm a pro LED guy, but if I'm giving you a new offering, I'm supposed to tell you this story before I compel you and say, okay, fine, go and use it.
So it helped you launch your personal care
range
better.
So I launched my brand with PKL.
Okay, and did you measure the success?
Well, I think in the first year, we were very much safe enough, I would say, within the margins. But second year, we grew because, we also participated in the second season. And we almost grew by 15% in the second year, after consuming PKL.
Which is in hardcore, hard metric, sale metric.
Yes,
sale
revenue.
So here you have one
learning,
awareness
right?
number and a learning on sales. Okay. So interestingly, in both these pieces, what I'm observing is that the brand life cycle or the life stage is actually common, He's talking about launching, and he's also talking about a newish, recent launch. And Nerolac here has been a brand which is like been around with us, but we'll hear from him, and I'll ask you soon about, how you have you used it. But before we move on to that question, on ROI, since we haven't taken Vikram's view, on discovery being relatively low reach, numbers are low, relatively while you're such large events that you do globally must be obviously so much money involved. How much are you able to really sell it to, sponsors? Is it tough? What is the way you have you seen success in sales? What is your view? Because the same aspect of what we are debating, what is ROI? What is a GRP? In your case, there's hardly any GRP per se that we are talking about. It's very, very low versus cricket, obviously. I'm not demeaning in any way, but slightly, you do understand the reach being so low. How difficult is it to sell your events?
So we don't sell GRPs. In fact, I would love to have a session with whoever can to, give it to our organization, because GRP is not a GRP strongly.
Absolutely, yes.
We look at three things which are meaningful to the brand to associate with. And there are these three filters which we put in before we decide to go ahead with any piece, which could then become relevant for the consumer. And if it's relevant for the consumer, it's going to be relevant for the brand. We really don't look at the brand and plan anything. So the three things which we actually look at, first is content. Is your content a killer piece of content? Is your content actually going to ensure that the consumer gets a feeling of FOMO? Fear of moving out, right? If I don't watch this, I'm missing out something. I think that's the first filter. And of course, from a discovery lens, we ensure that we put our filters, which is saying, does it ensure that it is satisfying human curiosity? That's one. So content is very, very important for any ROI. The second piece is community. We don't chase large mass audiences. So in our country, cricket and Bollywood is a religion. Now, when you look at this, this is more closer to the general entertainment space where you get masses and then you have definitions, new definitions like JRPs, etc. coming up. We don't get there. We believe in super fans. Super fans are nothing but passionate communities. These are individuals who want to associate with a set of content pieces. And if you're going to produce that, they are going to stick to you and they're going to spread the word as well. They do the viral effect for us. So, are you appealing to your passionate community? So the second C has to be satisfying that which is community.
Sorry to interrupt, Vikram, but do you see a fillip in your ratings, and what kind of a fillip?
Come to that. Yeah.
Because after all, we all measure that, right?
Absolutely. So there is content. There has to be community appeal before you produce any content, and the third piece is credibility. So if you are not going to be a credible brand or a platform or on that piece of content, because with more power comes more responsibility. If you have these three right, our experience in the past is you have brands flocking over there to partner with you because you are producing content which people want to. Coming to your piece on ROI, we are quite different when we do live events. Let me narrate a piece. We believe in informing audiences as much as inspiring them. So recently, a couple of months back, we had an event which was live into the blue hole. Once we announced these promos, etc., a lot of people, and in the few panels earlier, I think a few guys mentioned, saying the search quotient goes up. People start searching. So people start searching. Now, what is happening in live in the blue hole? It's basically 45 miles away from in Central America, where there is a territory which is still unexplored by human mankind. Nobody's actually been there. It is known for its blue crystal waters. It has tons of sharks and great sea life. Nobody's been there. Now there is an ocean expedition happening over there where people are trying to find what are the mysteries over there and what happened thousands of years ago. We'll go and shoot that and put it live. That stays. If you want to actually say that you have human curiosity to be addressed, you're not just going to watch it live. People watch it 1 year, 2 year, 5 years later. And that's how monetization and ROI works with killer content.
So also live, repeated various times.
You don't chase dollars live. If you make great content, you'll make enough money live, but
you'll
also make money later as well.
Did you get sponsors for
Absolutely.
The live? You did. So good. So you're saying that advertisers
We've already got one, Nerolac. Thank you for setting it up.
Oh, lovely. Okay, so coming back to the whole piece that we were discussing on the stage of the brand, which is where we saw that Siska, saw some success on personal care launch. You saw huge success on Tuvium. Let's hear from Piyushao. Nerolac has seen success, not necessarily launch, but kind of a relaunch of sorts, right? You refresh the brand in a way. Or if you have any learning that actually, launch and relaunch is not the only time you can do associations. Please share with us, because I think brand life cycle, clearly we believe new news does very well on live content.
Yeah, the granddaddy on the stage. We are going to be 100 next year. So
okay, great.
But no, not really launch, relaunch, but I would keep it in the realm of relevance. And every business, every brand needs to stay relevant. And by that logic, probably every day we are reinventing ourselves in some way or the other. One of the things which is a very important parameter to keep in mind, and before I get on to what we've done, is the conviction to stay in. So I'm very glad when I hear Amit talk about, the second year of PKL partnership and then suddenly the sales zooming. So that's something which you take heart from, that there's a conviction to stay in. And that goes beyond GRP numbers. Coming to what we've been doing, so we have a couple of brand assets which we've kind of nurtured over the years. One of them, as Vanita mentioned, is of our, our jingle. And last year we had, in fact, refreshed it, where we converted it into a complete song, and we went into regionals and we created multiple languages around this jingle. And so that kind of gave us an opportunity to integrate it into a lot of shows that were happening, which are Deferred Live
award shows, yeah.
A lot of concerts and award shows where it's a lot about celebration, it's a lot about happiness, and it kind of fits in, gets woven into the entire narrative very, very spontaneously. And that is when we got our jingle, to be sung by a lot of artists on the stage, a lot of anchor mentions, etc. Similarly, since we were partnering cricket on pre-post live, which is basically the Nerolac Cricket Live property, which we've been now building a couple of seasons. Now, on that also, when there are anchors who are singing your jingle, when there are senior commentators like Sunny Gavaskar singing or mentioning about it, suddenly you get a lift, and that's something which we've been kind of relying on.
So, do you measure that lift? Is there a measurement behind that?
It fits into the what I mentioned earlier, the recalls that we were measuring. So it fits in there.
So trauma does take up.
That's right.
And maybe some imagery scores or something like
imagery
that.
Imagery and trauma, both. Trauma. Mind measures as well as imagery. Yes.
Okay,
both.
Lovely. Great. So so bringing that learning here now, what I'm hearing him say is that even mature brands are using live event sponsorships basis synergy, right? So synergy is important, context is important. So that brings me to a point that, you know, Anupam mentioned that they brought a synergy and they did it pretty early on in the life stage, because usually synergy and context comes later in the brand life cycle stage. So why don't you just shed some light on how you see the importance of when you did that association, and, you know, how important is it to get the brand to be in the know, at least in the initial stage? Like if you hadn't built that 20 awareness and you straight away went into IPL with, you know, that property, would it have worked as well? What is your view on that?
No, I think going straight into a very property like IPL is a little hasty. I think we certainly need to establish the brand's basic proposition, and consumer need to be aware of it.
Mm-hmm.
What a live event does it is of course there is a context of the live event, what the program is. Here it is sports, it's all about energy, fitness, winning, competitiveness. Mm-hmm. And those are the things that if you want to espouse on your brand, then possibly it's a good fit. And depending on, you know, and doesn't matter really whether it is a cricket oriented fall of wicket property which happens 13 times in a match, typically any live event that you do, there will be multiple integrations. So I don't really consider a brand logo placement as integration or endorsement or sponsorship. There has to be something contextually built around the program seamlessly.
But don't you think like mature brands who are known, like Airtel today does a lot of, you know, fixed non-FCT stuff on cricket, etc. Not everything is contextual. So that's where I'm talking about how the brand life cycle versus context, is there a difference? Because I'm hearing you all say that context is critical. Obviously, context is excellent, but all brands can't manage it sometimes. So how important is it without the context also? Please. Anyone can.
No, I think it comes in, the context actually gets derived from the PLC or the life cycle itself. A new brand seeking to achieve a certain metric, sales or recall or awareness, would of course follow a certain brand guideline, or let's say a brand charter that they would have created. Look at Rolex, 40 years with Wimbledon.
Absolutely, yeah, that's a brilliant
I am still not able to define the brand metric that they would have put. It's precision. They launched the technology when it was introduced in Wimbledon in 2007, the ball tracking. Rolex was the one
Absolutely,
which brought it.
Absolutely, yeah, that's a brilliant example.
So from that perspective, context is something which I believe always is the driver force.
Okay.
For a new or for an existing brand. It's immaterial.
Actually, just to build on that, you know, if you look at Rolex, the same example, mm-hmm. if it is about technology, precision, premium association, all of that Wimbledon brings. And that's why it's such a long-standing association.
Bang on there, yeah.
As is for like cricket for a health brand. And I think that will remain eternally relevant as long as you have the resources to, of course, content and association can be taken to the next stage as you go year after year, which we see in the example of Rolex as well. They find newer and newer ways of reinforcing their proposition and getting that leadership edge. So I think that remains a job to be done for brands as you move from first year to second year. But context is absolutely, without context, I think the investment is not leveraged well enough. If the contextual fit is not there, then maybe you'll make the investment, but the kind of response and the return of investment you'll get will not be that large. And that's why contextual integration is extremely important.
Absolutely. So that's a big learning for all of us. So yes, visibility, spots are all okay, but can we do something contextually? Vikram, what is your say on discovery on such events when I asked you what kind of brands and you got Nerolac to partner? Do you think, again, more mature brands usually would come to... I do understand, of course, the context of the target audience. That, of course, given. But broadly, would there be more mature brands coming to your event sponsors as sponsors? Have you had some launch campaign or brand that you can think of that comes on your live event?
So, you know, just taking on from the contextual spot, which, Piyush and Anupam kind of said, I'm a strong believer for any brand, perception is greater than performance, right? So, GRP is not a GRP to the point. And that's very important because in a country like ours, where, you know, when you look at live events, it's largely sports, where cricket is maximum over there. What really happens in such scenarios is you have an array of brands kind of lining up over there, and whatever we see today in live sports, you know, you've got jerseys where, you know, I think teams are bidding against each other ki boss kitne logos aayenge. Yeah, so and they increase every year, and then the ground is flooded with lots of logos. So while contextual is important, I think it's even more challenging, and that opens up a world of new opportunities when you are fighting the only perception space. You will always say that there is something called share of voice. If a jersey has got so many, how do I create a surround around it? Because a logo on a jersey or anywhere else is not going to be enough. It's going to be a blind spot for sure. And when you start looking at what we do in the perception space, the share of voice has a very different dimension, whether it's events or it's any other content space that we are looking at. And when you look at live events specifically, it's nothing but, if I have to put it in one line, it's appointment viewing at its best, right? Because you've got the attention span of the individual over there. You've put down everything and said, okay, I want to go and watch this. And I want to watch it now, and I don't want to watch an action replay or probably the highlight as well. So that's going to be very, very important, saying, okay, hey, here there is cricket and there is something else which is getting created over here. So if you want share of voice and you want a more fit with the passionate community which is existing over there, there is nothing else which is available when you want to do it. And I think what's important is, can you also then look at, is there a possibility by the nature of the event or anything else, can you pre and post package it in a great way that it stays stronger with the consumer?
You're actually bringing us to the next point of discussion. That is, you know, how, especially in sports, which is the largest piece of live content, just to put some facts on the table, sports content is as high as 80 to 90% content-wise programming of live events. And in terms of, within that, cricket is the largest pie, which was earlier as high as 75 to 80%, but today it's become lesser, which is 60% or so. This is some stats I took from a leading sports channel. So that is where sports is and the importance. So what you were just highlighting, that there's so many elements today on sports, and how can we really leverage each element differently and you know, in conjunction? How much experience do we have on our own brands or from other brands that you so rightly brought in as Rolex on the effective use of not just sponsorship on television, but maybe combining, say, a team sponsorship or getting Virat, like you said, or whatever. So, Amit, if you can shed some light on, you know, how you've used a conjunction of things, you know, and do you have any examples of what you've done for Cisco?
See, I think right now we are at a very, very nascent stage of, you know, quoting a strong example as of now, I guess, because as I said, it's too early to say that, okay, I've achieved this or I have not yet achieved this, I think. But most importantly, as I said before also, are we moving in the right direction? Because there are a lot of choices right now that I have as an advertiser in the market right now, right from IPL, ISL, PKL and so on and so forth. But ultimately, what is my business objective, I think? And if I'm not able to define that the right way, then I think maybe I'm like anybody else, just chasing the visibility quotient. And I think that's too, you know, easier thing to sort of go ahead and get in television, because any which way is like a brand Cisco. We are putting in so much of money to go out and advertise otherwise also, right, throughout the year. So I think, is that what you're chasing as a brand? Absolutely no, I think. So yeah. I think that's
clear from across all of you that context is important and it's not just about visibility. Anupam, why don't you share with us, very interestingly you said to me when we were talking that you took up Pune as a test market and you, built a Pune team sponsorship. That's so interesting because, you know, how does the venue of the match really lend itself to, through a team sponsorship for your brand? How was that, your experience?
Yeah, I think it was when we were launching 2M, we also had the Pune Super Giants franchise for 2 years. The RPSG group owned the club. So I think it was more about when you are launching, of course, Delhi is the most important or the biggest snacking market, followed by Mumbai. Perhaps Gujarat is the biggest state. But actually, we chose Pune to launch. And I think it was also, the kind of emotional association that fans have with their respective clubs. I think here, because you also have a lot of association for IPL per se, but there are still fans who would like to take sides, right?
So there you were available only in Pune when your test launched?
So when we started the test market, we started only with Pune.
That's so interesting, right? Because we hear all south and, you know, how much can a market be, you know, de-linked. And you took up a sponsorship of Pune, which was on, after all, it was on national TV. And you chose to do Pune. I think that's an excellent learning. Very, you know, very
for
interesting.
For marketeers who have been there long enough, I mean, Pune actually is a torture test market.
Torture test.
And, you know, having spent about 17 odd years in Unilever, Pune is a difficult market. The consumer is extremely conscious, value conscious.
Please add.
Very, very evaluative.
Learning.
Well, not really. And, you know, whether it was at one point in time, Kellogg's launched something, they started to experiment in Pune. So I think if you succeed in Pune, there's a high chance you will succeed anywhere else.
Because I honestly didn't know that. That's learning for me, for person, please.
And I think, you know, if you're actually doing a test market on a new brand in Pune, of course, you had the leverage of the team on your side. And we had reasonable success, which actually helped us gain confidence that, yeah, if it can work in Pune, it can work anywhere else. Of course, we went to Delhi next because that's the biggest snacking market. But Pune was a good test case for us.
Excellent. You want to talk about something on Pune? Nothing. No comments. Okay. So now moving on, I think sports we've covered pretty much. I think we've heard some good learnings. One is, of course, about ROI, context, markets, different forms of sponsorships, timing, brand life cycle stage. A lot has been covered. Let me now quickly move on to news as a genre. And you know what our experience as panelists has been and what we think about how, because news, I think everyone knows today what part of the screen really gets seen as news and what part is really not there. So with that extreme clutter, what is our view on news as a genre? Whoever would like to take it, and particularly, of course, since you took laptop branding, in those days was it as cluttered, and versus now, you could talk about that.
So fundamentally, I think we have we are known for putting in a lot of money, you know, basically in the news genre. And thanks to that activity that we did for almost, I think, 4 years or something like that, I think the law of association has been like really fantastic between our category, which is LED, to a brand, which is Cisco, to even Irfan Khan, you know. So I think that is something that we are really proud about. But I was talking to somebody this week, and the person was from a news broadcasting team. Mm-hmm. He was from GEC actually. And he's like, Amit, you give a lot of money to news channels, but you don't give me enough and more money, right? And maybe, you know, he was in that sense sort of complaining or sulking. So, and then he said, see, I mean, like, there's a lot of entertainment out there because of GEC and all. So I heard him patiently. I said, so you are saying that in India, politics/news is not entertaining enough? I mean, like, look at, you know, what we have seen from last 4 or 5 years. You know, Namo and Raga and everything in between. And this guy was like, you know, for a minute, sort of like literally quiet. And he was like, no, I got your point. I said, yeah, if it is about entertainment, I'm deriving entertainment from news as well. You know, so what's the big deal? So I think, yeah, so laptop branding was one such small thing that we did otherwise. Yeah. But I think, we are in love with television, fundamentally.
That I think a lot of us are. you want to add? Yeah, please.
If I can add to the news aspect, I think news is also very cluttered.
Yes, absolutely. I think it is very.
But news channels are already creating their own space, own proposition, own traction. You know, if you, and I think everybody loves to take this example. If you look at Republic TV or no, I think it has just disrupted a whole lot of things. Now, there is a certain style of journalism, a certain style of reporting. If you feel that your brand's proposition aligns to that style, go ahead and do something. Create a unique property over there where every time there is a debate, there is something which that whole debate is getting branded as. And because I think news is also a high frequency medium. It's kind of some of the main programs are appointment viewing, much like soap operas.
Absolutely,
on TV.
Yeah.
You want to watch that 9 o'clock because you feel that there is something more that that particular program is giving you. So you go there again and again and again, and if you see a strongly branded property coming every day, then that's the kind of frequency you get on a daily basis. So it's a very strong reinforcement of your brand and your proposition almost on a daily basis. Again, it aligns to frequency. And because the genre, the style of communication on that news channel aligns with your brand or your brand's proposition, I think it possibly gives you a much richer dividend. So we haven't really done anything. but we are working with a lot of news channels to see what can be curated.
You're doing brainstorming right now on context.
But you know, the ideas that we are sharing with them, we are getting an instant connect with the news channels also, because they themselves want to do it. Because the kind of support we are giving through our Lending Our Brands proposition in to be able to create a news-based idea is having a lot of traction. So you'll see that in the next 2-3 months.
He's not going to talk about it now, otherwise we'll borrow his idea. Okay. Having heard that, I have a view on news, but I think it's hugely cluttered, and I'd like to pick Piyush's brain on that, and I think he may not like me too much on this, but you know, while they took up weather branding, for example. Now, weather branding goes with paints, yes. It also goes with waterproofing. It also goes with some other brands on weather. I don't know. I think a lot of brands have taken it. Even for that matter, laptop branding, actually, this question is for both of you. You know, what happens in news is unlike an IPL, which is one large big event. So if you have a property, you have and own that property. But in news, there are so many channels today. So even if you partner with the highest, maybe the topmost channel or the second most channel or the top three channels together, you have a huge risk, because there are so many other sponsors who do weather on other channels. So how do you kind of stand for weather, or how do you stand for laptop branding? Isn't that a huge challenge? And accept it if it is.
So I have a reason, and I also have a justification.
Okay.
But I'll probably stick to the statement I made earlier, stay convinced and, just stay in.
Okay.
So the idea is to, and I actually agree with what you're saying, and there is a specific reason why we have continued to build that, and somewhere, over the last couple of years, we've tried to see wherever possible we were very heavy on what is called as non-FCT.
Elements, yeah.
We were very heavy across channels, and in fact my team members are here, and they've been also, we've had a lot of sparring on this one. But somehow what we have done is we've kind of tried to channelize it and bring it in a certain direction. Of course, weather branding falls there. I remember, in fact, almost about 10 years back when it started, and I remember Mahindra Tractors, they had taken up weather
exactly,
branding.
Exactly, they went from here to there, right?
There
I
you
remember
go.
That.
And it worked then. We hope it will work now. I would not be able to share numbers at this stage. But it's about being convinced and staying in. I agree that the screen is cluttered, so we've tried to stay away from the live, from that context. Taza khabar or whatever, there are options which are there.
Yeah, those headlines and those
headlines,
et cetera.
So that somehow seems to be a blind spot now for, again, from our context.
And are you bullish on elections as a live event coming up now soon?
I would love to. The only problem is, opposed to cricket, the viewership gets divided when it comes
exactly,
to elections
that's
across
the whole
news
challenge,
channels,
right? Because that's not one channel; it gets that's the piece that I was.
So that's a conundrum, honestly, and still we would still be continuing to try and derive some sort of a metric in terms of how we work with it. But yeah, as a live property, of course, it is juicy enough from an Indian context, and especially the.
As a consumer, even as an advertiser, do we all remember top three brands on sponsors of elections? We don't, right? Because IPL, we get names, but I think elections, we don't, right? At least I don't.
It's recency.
Yeah, it's recency, and it's just too cluttered. It's like every channel has a different name, and that's a huge, con that I see, that I put on the table. Should we open the house for questions? Yeah? Oh my God, okay. Yeah, that's only one. All right, great. The images see the weight.
My name is Dharmendra Rai. I'm a marketing consultant to a few local companies as well as to a few Fortune 500 companies. I was just wondering, isn't a live event for the purpose of branding and all this very, very risky? Just two things that I've thought of. One is, I would never see a Filmfare Award or an Oscar Award live because it's terribly boring. Just watching a person get up from a chair and walking itself is very boring. And the second thing is, suppose you have a celebrity and he comes late. For example, Nokia did something with Shah Rukh Khan. He came late and people literally didn't have any questions for him, and he was ignored till the chief executive of Nokia said, do you want to talk to Shah Rukh Khan at all? So
the subject today is live event on TV to that extent. I mean, of course, the risk is the same, right?
You got a celebrity, you got some important people, you got an important event lined up, and that doesn't happen for some reason. It can backfire very badly.
I think on television it gets covered usually on such things because we are talking on TV.
Yeah.
So even if there's somebody late in the event, it won't show up so clearly on television when it comes up because we have a deferred life concept of awards. If you're talking about award shows,
that's just a metaphor. Yeah. Other things also can go wrong. Some machinery doesn't work or stuff of that sort. So, I'm just wondering,
sports is the largest live event we spoke about. Elections are second. In these things, there are not such pieces, right? So, yeah, I mean, shows, yes, some things can go wrong. But then you go with the partners who have the most experience and the lead partners usually manage these things well. Their small faux pas may happen. You may like to add because he does things at such grand scale and things can...
So, which is what I was mentioning exactly, you know, credibility is very important. So, if there is any broadcaster who's planning to do anything live, it's nowhere close to what happens in daily life of a broadcaster when it comes to production. So, you're absolutely right, but there is a lot which goes before you do live and all these things are taken care of, whether the celebrity is there. And then, like she mentioned, Vanita mentioned, it's deferred live. So, you edit a lot of things and you have to take care of a few things because you don't want to bore the consumer. So if it's a 4-hour affair on ground, you want to cut it and maybe it makes sense to put a 3-hour so that deferred live takes care of a lot of things. There are very few events which actually go straight up live. Mostly it's sports.
We are on time. Let's give them a big round of applause. Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you, Vanita Keswani.